Well, good morning, guys. What a beautiful day today. I drove up to the church in Spire, was there against that blue sky, and I thought, you know, some days I drive up and it's dark and stormy back behind it, and some days it's bright blue, but Spire's still there, either way. But wow, what a day today. So I want to share with you this scripture. One of our scripture readers said, oh, I don't know if I can read that. Scripture. This one is a little challenging, maybe. So listen. This is from Colossians 3. This is in the context of all of Colossians 3, which you're familiar probably with 12 through 17, which is we read in a lot of weddings. Clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, meekness, patience. And it begins with strip off the old self. And then put on the new self. And then there is an application into a particular context. But listen, whatever you do in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. Wives, be subject to your husbands as is fitting in the Lord. Husbands, love your wives and never treat them harshly. Children, obey your parents in everything, for this is your acceptable duty in the Lord. Fathers, do not provoke your children or they may lose heart. Slaves, obey your earthly masters in everything, not with a slavery performed merely for looks, to please people, but wholeheartedly fearing the Lord. Whatever task you do, work as if your soul depends on it, for as for the Lord and not for humans. Since you know that from the Lord you will receive the inheritance as your reward, you serve the Lord Christ. For the wrongdoer will be paid back for whatever wrong has been done. There is no partiality. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Pray with me. Gracious God, open us up today to whatever your living word is within these words. Open our eyes that we might see and ears that we might hear and our hearts that we might feel. And then, O God, open our hands that we might serve. Amen. If you've ever had a teenager, there's one word that probably annoys you more than any other word, at least for me it did, and that is the word whatever. They would say that all the time. You need to do your homework. Whatever. And then, right? Or, you know, you got to be in by 11. Whatever. Now, here's what whatever meant. Whatever meant was, yes, I will obey. But I refuse to respect you in the midst of it. I mean, it is, in a sense, a statement of disrespect, right? Whatever was implied like, I think you're an idiot, but I'll do it anyway because you've got all the cards, is kind of what the whatever says. And I think it's the tone that's the problem. Because with the right tone, the term whatever makes a lot of sense. And I want you to see it. It's twice in this passage. I think it's the most important word in the passage. Verse 17. Whatever you do in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. Or in verse 23. Whatever task you must do, work as if your soul depends on it, as for the Lord and not for humans. So whatever. Whatever your situation. All right, I want to do a little review before we go on any farther. This is the last in our series of sermons. And I want us to think about what we've learned, what we've considered about how we take our faith into our workplace. And the first thing we said was that we work in order to participate in God's provision. Right? God's provision. We work to make a living. We work to feed our families. That's our first ministry, is our family. But we don't just participate in God's provision for ourselves, but for others. Remember, the scripture says, those who are thieves must give up stealing. Let them labor with their own hands, comma, so as to have something to share with the needy. We participate in God's provision for all people. The second thing we talked about was that we are called to tend the system. We have a particular part in God's economy, in God's ecosystem, in God's purposes. God created a world. God created a world that was supposed to run, that was supposed to function, to honor God and to care for people. And every one of us has a little part to play in that, in this interdependent system. And when we begin to understand our part, it's the old thing. Some people say, I'm building the old story about the bricklayer. One guy says, well, I lay bricks. Another one says, well, I'm building a wall. And the third says, I'm building a cathedral. The wall is a part of the cathedral. The bricks are part of the wall. But when you begin to understand that you're part of the building of the cathedral, when you understand that you have a part to play in God's system and can come to understand that, then you take a different spirit into your workplace. The third thing we said was that you have to take a break. That in fact, the only commandment about work in Scripture is about not working. And that's a way to say, I'm going to reorder my priorities so that trusting God is first. That I'm not going to go back to be a slave again to my work. I'm going to trust God and do what God says and take that break. And then last week, what did we talk about? I hate it when that happens. Oh, yeah. Last week we said that your ministry is the people in your workplace, right? That's your mission field. If you have a Rolodex, you have a ministry. So you go into that place and do whatever you can to bless the people in your workplace, because perhaps that's why you've been sent there, not to do the tasks, but to care for the people that are there. So today, then, we want to close with this basic premise that is, in whatever place you are, in whatever workplace you've been put, make an offering. Do your work as an offering of God, an act of worship, offering it to God. So I want to address the issue of this passage directly. It's obviously not aimed specifically at workplaces, except, I guess, this part about slaves. Sometimes what we do when we interpret Scripture is we say one of two things. We say, okay, here's this Scripture written to a particular cultural context, and we are to interpret it literally. And so we need to live by that cultural context. There are some people who do that. There are another way sometimes people say is that was applicable to that, or that was written into that cultural context, and that cultural context isn't ours anymore, so I'm going to throw it out. I'm going to do the Thomas Jefferson approach and cut it out of the Bible. That's what he did. The stuff he didn't like, he just cut it out, and so he didn't have to deal with it anymore. And we do that a lot of times. We say, you know, that doesn't apply to us. The culture's changed, everything's different, so let's ignore that. Both ways, I think, misunderstand. Paul is writing this to a particular situation, but he's explaining a particular truth and applying it to that situation. So what we need to do is look at what is that truth and how it was applied to that situation in that cultural context and say, how do I apply that to mine? So when you dig deeper beneath this particular scripture, you see, so what is the underlying truth that Paul is teaching? And I would tell you that the underlying truth is that sometimes we are in situations, in circumstances that are based on our culture, based on our life, and we have to choose how we will approach those in our minds and in our hearts. Viktor Frankl wrote one of the most significant books in my life called Man's Search for Meaning. I've quoted it 1,000 times to you. I hope you'll read it sometime. But he comes out of his experience in the concentration camps. And he said, the last of the great human freedoms is the freedom to choose one's attitude in any given set of circumstances. In my life, I would tell you that on that spectrum of things you can't change, serenity to accept the things you can't change, courage to accept the things you can, and the wisdom to know the difference, as you get older, what you realize is that more and more things move down into the serenity thing. Right? There are things you can't change. When I was a younger pastor, I would think, maybe I'll go back to law school and become a lawyer. I don't think that anymore. That's not a possibility. I'm not going to go be a doctor, because I thought about that for a while. Right? At some point you realize this is it. Right? And you have to say, what will my attitude be in this situation? This particular scripture is not trying to endorse this cultural setting, but to say, this is the cultural setting you're in. Maybe you can change it, maybe you can't. But within that set of circumstances that is reality, how will you live your heart and life? I will tell you that there was a really significant moment in my ministry. My kids were small, and I was missing a game that one of my kids was in because I had a meeting. And so I had this conversation. I was looking at my calendar, and it was meeting and meeting and meeting and meeting. And I thought, all I do is go to meetings. And I said to my daughter, I'm so sorry, I won't be able to be at your game. I have a meeting. And I don't know, she was 8 or something. And she said, well, what is a meeting? And I said, well, we gather together and we talk about stuff that's about the church. And she said, well, what do you do? And I thought, and I said, well, nothing. we don't do anything at the meeting. We talk about doing things, but we don't actually do anything. And I was so frustrated at that moment, and I thought, what? And so I had a conversation with a good friend. You know, you always have somebody you want to unload on. And my friend said, that's like everybody's life. He was kind of like, well, why do you think your life should be different? You know, he said, that's everybody's life. He said, the baker bakes. Right? The garbage collector picks up garbage. Pastors go to meetings. That's what you do. I mean, that's part of the job. You can whine about it all you want to, but that's what you do. And the question is, will you do what you do, whatever it is you do, remember that whatever you do, will you make it an offering to God? Will you change the attitude and reason for what you do. So let's talk about three specific things very quickly here. I want you to look with me at verse 22. Slaves, obey your earthly masters in everything, not with the slavery performed merely for looks, but to please people, but wholeheartedly fearing the Lord. So that word wholeheartedly is the word cardias. That means heart. And it's translated wholeheartedly here. It's translated with heart other places. It literally is with heart. I would tell you that I think what it's saying is whatever we do, do it in love. Do it out of your heart. A couple of weeks ago, I was out in front of our house putting up ghosts for Halloween, you know, hanging them on the front. And my wife was supervising this action. She's standing in front supervising. And I'm on a ladder kind of leaning out with a little fishing line trying to hang these ghosts so that they're facing the correct direction. And she's out on the sidewalk. And our neighbor drives up and unrolls her window. And she says, "You win the Husband of the Year award." That's the only reason I've included this in the sermon is so that you know that I have won the Husband of the Year award. And my wife turned to her and said, "He only does it because he loves me." And that's true. I could care less about ghosts on Halloween. I don't care if they're facing the right direction. I don't care if they're lit up or not lit up. I don't care if they have the right amount of fiberfill inside them. I don't care about any of those things. I only do what I do in that situation out of love for her. And when, I'll have to be honest with you, when I find myself getting resentful and annoyed, I think, why are you doing this? You're doing this out of love for her. And it changes everything. When you are going through some part of your work and you think to yourself, why am I doing this? I don't care about this. T- to think to yourself, this is my offering to God. This is what I do. This is my offering. And I want to do it out of love for God. Do you realize that we're all called to be amateurs? The word amateur we think of as sort of like not a professional, right? The word amateur is a French word that comes from the Latin word that's amator, meaning lover. We do what we do because we love. That's what we're called to be. A few months ago, we had a memorial service here, and we have these witnesses, and a granddaughter was talking about her grandmother. And she said, my grandmother was a great cook. She cooked so many great things. They all tasted good. I can't remember a lot of the specifics of them, she said. She listed a couple of her favorite dishes. But then she said this line, which, boy, was great. She said, but everything my grandmother cooked, just like everything she did, was flavored with love. And I think that is the spirit that we have when we go to our workplace. We can sit around and think to ourselves, I wish I had a different boss. I wish I had a different assignment. I wish I had a different team. I wish I had was in a different place. All of those things we may think, gosh, I wish it was different. But when our mind changes to say, but whatever it is I'm doing right here and right now, I'm going to do it with love. Here's the second thing. Then we look at the next verse. He says, whatever task is verse 23, whatever task you must do, work as if your soul depends on it, as for the Lord and not for humans. This idea of our soul is the word psyche. It really means the life force in Greek. It's often identified with the mind, but it really is about the soul. It's the Greek word for soul. It's the life force within us. Do it like your life depends on it. Do it with excellence, as good as you can do it. All right, here's a moment of self confession. I'm kind of, in many ways, a good enough guy. Like I am okay, that's good enough. Oh, that's probably good enough. And I think there are times that's helpful, because there's only so much time in your day, right? And some things are important and some things are not important. And on the things that are not important, sometimes you have to say, that's good enough. I'm going to let that be good enough right now, so that I can spend my energy on the thing that matters, the thing that really is important, and I want to do that with excellence. And even that decision needs to be made with excellence. I think that's the real key. But as I have grown older and looked at my own heart and life, I've come to realize that sometimes that's an excuse. And that whether we do things with excellence or not has a lot to do with who we are and not what it is we're doing. So when the scripture says, those who are faithful with little will be faithful with much, is an important picture. Those little things matter. Have you seen the t-shirt? It's one of my favorites, that says punctuation matters. Do you know that one? Punctuation matters. It says, let's eat grandma, or let's eat grandma. Just that comma makes a big difference, right? You got to get it right. If I get a resume that has misspellings in it, maybe spelling doesn't matter that much. But I'm not going to hire a person with misspellings in their resume. If you are sending your resume to Jesus, if you're going to send your work report on what you've done with your life to Jesus, don't you think that you want it to be excellent? That you want it to be as good as you can get? Pretend that it's Dad's birthday, and children 8 and 10 have decided to make Dad breakfast in bed. And they bring the breakfast in bed, and the eggs are soggy, runny, and the bacon is not, you're not sure whether you ought to eat it because it's really not cooked enough. And the toast is burned, and they bring it and say, Dad, happy birthday, we love you. And Dad is like, wow, that's awesome, how nice. But if Mom brings breakfast in bed, and the eggs are runny, and the bacon's not cooked, and the toast is burned, Dad does not feel deeply loved or honored, right? That this was not done in an excellent way. we have to do the best that we can in our offerings to God. On Sundays, some sermons are pretty good. Some are not as good. And on the Sundays that are not as good, my sadness is not so much that the sermon is not as good, but generally it's because I think to myself, man, you could have done better. You could have worked harder at that. You could have been ready earlier. You could have not settled for that halfway illustration. You didn't do the exegesis. You just went right to the work, right to the sermon. You didn't really exegete the passage. You took shortcuts. And then I don't feel like I'm making an offering to God. All right. Do it with excellence. Here's the final thing. Verse 24. Since you know that from the Lord you will receive the inheritance. Since you know that from the Lord you will receive the inheritance as your reward, you serve the Lord Christ. Serve. The word is doulos, servant, slave sometimes. It is a sense of saying, I am primarily to be a servant. In my neighborhood, across the street from me, lives Mr. Harper, catty corner. Mr. Harper's the mayor of our block. He's been there for, long time. Longer than, I've been there 16 years, and he was there long before me. And he's a Baptist. He's a good Baptist. That's okay. Same Jesus. But he is amazing in his servant spirit. Always going to every neighbor, whoever moves in, checking on them, harvests things out of his garden, brings them to ours, knows my wife's a vegetarian, so he brings her vegetables, brings jalapeno poppers. We have these little yippy dogs, so he always brings over his bones. He doesn't have a dog, so he brings bones for our dogs, and we don't have the heart to tell him that we don't give our dog bones, but he brings the bones over because he thinks our little yippy dogs would like them, and he is just wanting to serve us. What would it be like if you said, instead of thinking how to fix or be critical or judge the person in the carrel next to you at work, in the person who your boss or the person who works for you, or what if instead of thinking, how can I fix them or how can I judge them in some way, being critical of them, what if instead you thought completely, how can I serve them today? How can I serve them? Everything would change. That this picture of being of a servant heart would make all the difference. Galatians 6:22 says, bear one another's burdens, for in that way you fulfill the law of Christ. There's a poem I want to share with you. It's kind of one of those old sing-songy ones, but I love what it says. It's by a guy named Meade McGuire. Father, where shall I work today? And my love flowed warm and free. And then he pointed out a tiny spot and said, tend that for me. I answered quickly, oh no, not that. Why, no one would ever see, no matter how well my work was done, not that little place for me. And the word he spoke, it was not stern. He answered me tenderly. Ah, little one, search that heart of thine. Art thou working for them or for me? Nazareth was a little place, and so was Galilee. Who are you working for? There's this picture in the Old Testament that I love, that when the children of Israel would make burnt offerings, the question is, are they pleasing in the nostrils of the Lord? Is what you do pleasing in the nostrils of the Lord? Is it done with love, with excellence, with a servant heart? Make that decision that whatever you do, whatever place you've been placed, make it an offering and pleasing to the Lord. Gracious God, we give you thanks. We give you thanks for giving us tasks to do. Some of them we love doing. Some of them we do just because we love you. But we ask that you would help us to change our mindset, our attitude, so that we might take our faith into our workplace and make everything we do an offering to you. In the name of Christ we pray. Amen.